My dear brothers and sisters, we are going to take a quick look at Genesis chapter 41, verse 55 to 57, then chapter 42, verse 5 to 7, and verse 17 to 24. I repeat, Genesis chapter 41, verse 55 to 57, then chapter 42, verse 5 to 7, and verse 17 to 24. I read, "But when all Egypt too began to feel the famine, and the people appealed to Pharaoh for food, Pharaoh told all the Egyptians, 'Go to Joseph and do whatever he tells you.' There was famine all over the world. Then Joseph opened all the granaries and they rationed out grain to the Egyptians as the famine grew even worse in Egypt. People came to Egypt from all over the world to get supplies from Joseph. And for the famine had grown severe throughout the world. Thus, the son of Israel were among the other people who came to get supplies. There had been famine in Canaan. It was Joseph, as the man in authority over the country, who allocated the rations to the entire population. So Joseph's brothers went and bowed down before him, their faces touching the ground. As soon as Joseph saw his brothers, he recognized them. But he did not make himself known to them, and he spoke harshly to them. 'Where have you come from?' he said. 'From Canaan to get food,' they replied. Whereupon he put them all into custody for 3 days. On the third day, Joseph said to them, 'Do this and you will live, for I am a man who fears God. If you are honest men, let one of your brothers be detained where you are imprisoned. The rest of you go and take supplies home for your starving families. But you must bring your youngest brother back to me. In this way, what you have said will be verified, and you will not have to die.' And this is what they said. And they said to one another, 'Clearly, we are being punished for what we did to our brother. We saw his deep misery when he pleaded with us, but we would not listen. And now this misery has come home to us.' Reuben retorted to them, 'Did I not tell you not to wrong the boy? But you would not listen. Now comes the accounting.' They did not know that Joseph understood, because there was an interpreter between them. He turned away from them and wept. When he was able to speak to them again, he chose Simeon out of their number and had him bound while they looked on." And this is the word of the Lord. My dear brothers and sisters, the Bible is full of interesting stories, and the story we read happened to be one of those popular stories that we know about in the scripture. And this is simply about the man called Joseph, who was betrayed by his own brother or brothers. And my brothers and sisters, we have so many stories in the scripture that talks about betrayal, Now, the betrayal of Joseph by his brothers happened to be one of the classical betrayal stories. And I'm not going to spend much time on talking about the betrayal of Joseph by his brothers because we already know those stories. But I want to share with you that in the course of my missionary activities, people oftentimes tell me how they were betrayed. And many of them live with such a hurt. People have been betrayed, you know, in the family. Maybe your brother have betrayed you, or your sister, or your close relatives, maybe an uncle. And in most devastating cases, parents may, even in most cases, betray their children. And so you see the one that was betrayed living in pains, living in unforgiveness. You see them living the rest of their life in agony. And so, my dear people of God, God is using the ministration of this night to bring us to how to deal with betrayal. When you are betrayed, how do you handle it? We're not saying that betrayal is easy to handle, but you know what? When we do it the way Joseph did his own, then God will definitely give us the grace to overcome the situation and even give us the grace to do good to those who betray us. Now, if I ask you, have you been betrayed? You probably would tell me, not just once, not just twice. You may tell me several times. I'm yet to see somebody who has not been betrayed. And if you have not been betrayed, I would tell you congratulations. I have seen friends betraying friends. I have seen even your close confidants betraying you or betraying their associates. And my brothers and sisters, when this kind of thing happens, the devil tries to take advantage to make us to live our lives in bitterness. And when we start living our lives in bitterness, then we lack the joy of communion with God. We lose the joy of fellowshipping with the saints. And this is a strategy of the devil to make the child of God to live his life in resentment, to spend all the time, all his quality time, brooding in regrets. This thing that was done to me, I must see to the end of it. And many a time, you want to fight the battle. You want to fight the person to a full stop. You want to spend the whole of your lifetime looking for how to hurt that person. I once read a book years ago. In this book, the person that was betrayed, you know, betrayed so badly that he spent all his lifetime, even to the end, to the point of being an old man, he was still hunting for the person that betrayed him. He was still hunting, going from village to village, from nation to nation, looking for that person. My brothers and sisters, this is not the way forward. The Bible wants to teach us the way forward. Give it to the Lord in prayer. Take it to Jesus. And let me even tell you, Jesus himself was betrayed. Not by an outsider, but by a friend. Somebody he called a friend. Do you remember that Jesus called Judas a friend? Judas was an outsider. Judas was one of the 12, you know, apostles of Jesus. And in the caucus of Jesus' government or council or cabinet, you know, his inner confidence, people that eat with him, Judas was there. In spite of the fact that he was very close to Jesus, yet his heart was very far away. And while all of them were gathered, he was gathering for a different purpose. Jesus. And so the enemy used him to betray Jesus. And when the hour of betrayal came, Do you know that Jesus looked eyeball to eyeball with Judas? He said, friend, do what you want to do. What Jesus saw in Judas that made him call Judas friend is what Wakwe does not know. But yeah, he saw in Judas something good that made him say, friend, do what you want to do. He didn't tell him, criminal, do what you want to do. Jesus. My dear people of God, Jesus did not live his life in regrets of what Judas did. Mm-mm. No. Neither did Joseph spend his lifetime brooding in bitterness. No. He took it to the Lord. He handed it over to the Lord. He kept praying to the Lord. He kept calling on God day and night. And brother, let me tell you something. If anyone had reason to break relationship with families because of things done against you, Joseph would be a candidate. And he would have reasons why he wouldn't do anything whatsoever with his family again. You remember they wanted to kill him. It was one of his brothers that said, no, why didn't why commit such atrocity? Why should we stain our hands with blood of our own brother? He said, let us sell him out. And they sold him. Would somebody do you that kind of thing and you will still have the audacity to have ties with such family, with such person, with such friend or business associate, or with such spouse? Or let me even put it this way. If somebody does this kind of thing to you, I mean, you taking the position of Joseph, would you ever even have reason not to break ties with such person or persons? Jesus. Such things, even to have a capacity as this, that just a pass-through, had happened to so many people. And they did not only broke ties with their people, but they broke ties with God. So where was God when they were planning all this? Why did God allow this? And many of them today have become atheists because they felt that God was not fair to allow these things to happen. My brothers and sisters, none of us have been sold into slavery, but Joseph was sold into slavery, not by strangers, but by his own brothers. Oh my goodness. Do you really understand what that means? He was sold into slavery by his own family members. Joseph found himself in a foreign country, not by his own wish. He didn't plan that. He never went to the embassy to get a visa to Egypt. No. Overnight, his plan changed. Overnight, he was sold to strangers. Not by foreigners, but by his own household brothers and sisters. Sometimes when the enemy wants to fight you, and they use outsiders as instruments to fight you, if it becomes difficult, then they will go and use the person closest to you, even family members. Jesus. The worst war you can ever fight is the war in the house. A war with somebody that you dip your hands into the same plate. That's the worst war. I hear my people say that it is the rat inside of the house that told the one outside of the house that there is a fish hidden somewhere in the house. Jesus. Many of us are fighting such war. You go outside and you fight external wars. People gather against you and they fail to get you. And then only for them to get you through your own blood relatives, your own people. And that is a great, unspeakable heartbreak. The Bible says in Amos chapter 5, verse 19, that it is as though a man fled from a lion, you know, only to meet a bear, as though he entered his own house and rested his hand on the wall, only to be beaten by a snake. You know what that means? That it is like a man who was chased by a lion outside. And then this man was running and running. And at the point he thought it was over, that he had run away from the lion. And at the point of resting, look at a bear. A bear. And these are terrible animals. And then on seeing the bear, he got up. Ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. He now ran into his own house. In other words, the bear and the lion were representing enemies from outside. When this man ran into the house, and then he rested in his own house and said, wow, so finally I've come to the house of safety. Wow, as he was panting, behold, a snake came out from the wall only to bite his finger. Go and check Amos chapter 5, verse 19. That's what the Bible says. That it is like a man fled from a lion only to meet a bear, as though he entered the house and rested his hand on the wall only to have a snake bite him. Many of us are like that. You escape the dangers outside, but inside, venomous snakes are waiting. My brothers and sisters, this was the situation of Joseph. Yet, Joseph continued to look unto God. Yet, Joseph remained faithful. Yet, he remained prayerful. He continued to have fellowship with God. This man, Joseph, passed through different positions in his life, different situations in his life. When he was in his father's house, he had a position called the father's favorite. You remember the coat of many colors? Joseph had the coat of many colors. His father made it for him. He was the most beloved of his father. That was the position he had in the house. Although that was a position that attracted envy. You know, I remember many of us pass through things we pass through, even in the house, because of the position that we occupy. Joseph occupied that position of his father's beloved. He also, from there, passed the position of slave. When he was sold to Egyptians, he became a slave. Can you imagine from grace to grass? Then from being a slave, he ended up in the prison, and he became a prison inmate. That is a stage in life. That is a position. And then from the prison inmate, he became an administrator, a governor, an assistant to the prime minister. Life is like that, brother. You may pass through the season of joy, the season of, slave, a season of being in prison. Things you struggle, things don't work out the way you think it will work out. Nothing moves. But after that position comes the position of honor as an administrator. I am praying this night that God will recognize the stage you are passing through now and bring you to the limelight. Just like in the rosary, we have the joyful mysteries. We have the sorrowful mysteries. We have the luminous mysteries. and so on and so forth. And I tell you something, so is life. We pass through different spiritual mysteries in our lives. Joseph passed through those experiences, and then at the end, God brought him to the glorious mystery. And I tell you, as we continue to look unto God, the author and finisher of our faith, indeed, we will come to the glorious mystery. In the name of Jesus. Joseph looked to God for wisdom, and he looked unto God for strength to serve God. He resisted temptations. You know the temptation that came to Joseph? He resisted those temptations because he didn't want to defile himself. Jesus. So, my brothers and sisters, when all these things happened, and at the end, God blessed Joseph and put him in a position of leadership, in a position of taking care of people at the national level, being the apple of the eyes of God. God put him in that envious position, that wonderful position. And that was the position he was when there was famine all over the world. Jesus. And look at his brothers coming to him. He recognized that these were his brothers. Now, he was in a position to hunt them, to deal with them, to make them suffer. He had the position to put them in the prison. According to the way we do things in the world, we would say, oh, my enemies are in my trap. And let me tear them teeth for that. That was not what Joseph did. Joseph showed love to his enemies. Hallelujah. So you see what? That's what the Bible is talking to us this night. He's saying, show love to your enemies, those who have hurt you. I don't know who had this message. But those who are hurt us, God wants to show love. Jesus. My brothers and sisters, Joseph proved himself to his brothers by lavishing mercy on them. Yes, Lord. Mm-hmm. He showed mercy to his brothers and sisters, to his own people. Jesus. Oh, my brothers and sisters, I don't know how many of us that have been haunted so much. Many of us have been carrying the badge of sorrow so much because of what people have done, what close relatives have done against you. Probably they killed your father, your mother, or they killed your elder brother, and you have lost joy. God wants to deal with that this night. He wants to talk to us. Oh, Jesus. We are going to forgive them. We are going to leave it to the Lord. The Bible says in Mark chapter 11, verse 25, it says, and when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive him, so that your Father in heaven may forgive you your sins. When Jesus is at the center of our lives, we can expect his reconciliation within ourselves and with others. The Holy Spirit will not let us off the hook in our broken relationships, nor will he expect us to forgive in our own power. No. We cannot forgive in our own power. The Holy Spirit will do it through us as we let him to do it. Maybe your spouse has betrayed you. Ever since that your first marriage ended up in divorce, you have lost joy and you are living in bitterness. God is talking to us in this fellowship to give it to him, to give it to the Lord. It is better that we drop it and leave it to the Lord and then seek the face of the Lord, so that when we pray, then the door will open, the windows of heaven will open, and then God will now send his dues of mercy and strength upon us. The real thing about unforgiveness is that when we are unforgiving, then God We ourselves are locking ourselves in a prison-like situation. God doesn't want that. We're going to make a decision today like Joseph to be reconciled with that person in my life, in your life, that has hurt us most. We must resolve, like Joseph, to set them free. And even to set ourselves free. It's us. I tell people, life is too short. And there's no provision for us to live our lives in pains. Yes, Lord. Jesus. Life is too precious to be wasted with resentment. Many people are trapped in a prison of resentment. A lot of people are bound in the chains of unforgiveness. But this night, God is calling on you. He said, let it go. It's ours. Let it go. Don't hang on there in that unforgiveness. Do it like Joseph. Jesus, show that mercy to that man or woman that has offended you. Do not worry how God will handle it. God wants our cooperation. Jesus. My dear brothers and sisters, God is talking to us in the name of Jesus. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7 to 8, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us with all wisdom and with all understanding. Oh, Jesus, Holy Father, King of Kings, the mighty man in battle, we choose today to forgive everyone in our lives that has offended us, Lord, including ourselves. But Father, we're asking for forgiveness. Give us the grace to forgive ourselves and also to forgive those who has offended us, Lord. Jesus. Father, give us the grace to move forward, Lord, to keep it behind and move forward. Jesus. We forgive ourselves for our sins, for our faults, for our failings. We forgive ourselves for not doing the right thing, even for not forgiving ourselves. Jesus. For picking on others, for even picking on ourselves. Jesus. For being our own worst enemies. There are people who are their own worst enemies. Father, we are asking for forgiveness. And Father, release us from that situation, even as we are praying now. Give us the prayer, the freedom, the grace to be free, Lord. Oh, Jesus, touch us in a special way. Let your peace come into our hearts. In the name of Jesus. Oh, Jesus, touch us, oh Lord. Let the power of your Holy Spirit touch your people. Touch your people, Lord. In the name of Jesus. Jesus, Holy Father. We are praying now for forgiveness of those who have hurt us in the family. Any way that my mother or my father or my spouse has offended me so badly that I'm bearing grudges or resentments or I'm brooding day and night. Father, that spirit of unforgiveness, I command that spirit right now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Come on! Jesus, Jesus, let your spirit come out in the name of Jesus. My body cannot harbor them again in the name of Jesus. Jesus, let your power flow. Let your power flow. My people, begin to pray now. Call upon him now. The cleansing agent, the blood of Jesus, is moving now. He is moving now to touch us, to revive us, to renew us in the name of Jesus. Jesus, yes, my Lord. Whatever thing my parents or my spouse have done against me, Father, I am forgiving them now for any or every negativity or unlove that they have extended to me throughout my life, knowingly or unknowingly. Father, we are forgiving them now in the name of Jesus for any abuse that I have extended to me. Father, I forgive now in the name of Jesus. Jesus, for any way, they have failed to give me satisfying blessings. Oh, Makandaraba. Father, Lord, we are forgiving now. We are forgiving them now. In the name of Jesus, I forgive my children for every way they have disobeyed or become rebellious in any form or manner. Father, I forgive them now. Jesus, I forgive my siblings in the name of Jesus, even my blood relatives, for every abuse they have done against me. Father, we forgive them now in the name of Jesus. I forgive my friends for any action of negativity or betrayal they have extended to me. Oh, Jesus, anyway they have extended this betrayal in our relationship or abuse our relationship or led me astray, Father, we forgive them now in the name of Jesus. I forgive them now in the name of Jesus. Jesus, yes, my Lord, I release them now from every bondage and I make peace with them now. I make peace with them today in the power of the Holy Spirit. Jesus, I forgive my fellow employers in the name of Jesus. Yes, my Lord, my fellow employees, I also forgive them in the name of Jesus. Jesus, Father, touch them now in the name of Jesus. My school teachers, even the government, even the society, I forgive now in the name of Jesus. Oh, Jesus, yes, my Lord, thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Oh, Jesus. The story of Joseph is really a story of God's faithfulness. Joseph was faithful to God. Come rain, come sun, he was faithful. As a slave, he was faithful. As a prisoner, he was faithful. So even when God made him an administrator, a ruler, he was still faithful. Jesus. God blessed the works of his hands. God gave him the remarkable spiritual insights that caught the attention of Pharaoh. And because he was faithful to God, at the right time, in God's own time, God now promoted him. You see, every faithfulness ends up in promotion. I repeat, every faithfulness ends up in promotion. When you are faithful to God, it doesn't matter the things you pass through. It doesn't matter the situation you pass through. It doesn't matter what people say about you or against you. As you remain faithful, hey, then a time is coming for a reward, because surely you must receive a reward. Joseph passed through time of slave, time of as a prison inmate, and yet he remained faithful, and God rewarded him. You see that good thing you are doing? You think that nobody's seeing you. God is seeing that good, those good things you are doing, and he's recording them. A day of reward is coming. The Bible says in Isaiah chapter 3, verse 10, tell the righteous that it is well with him. Yes, Lord. Don't give up. People may tell you, stop doing this good thing you are doing. You have done it for many years. What is your gain? I am here to tell you, keep doing that good thing you are doing. You don't know the day you will do good to an angel. You see, when we talk about the life of Abraham, you know, all of us know that he had a wife, Sarah, who had no child for years of the marriage. Do you know that it was the day the angels God sent to Sodom and Gomorrah, to go and destroy the city of Sodom and Gomorrah? These angels, they came to where Abraham was. Abraham was sitting down, taking a cool rest in the evening. Then he saw these people, three people walking by. He said, oh, come and drink water in my house. Come and sit down. Come and take rest. Eventually, he offered them rest in the house. He fed them, gave them sumptuous, you know, entertainment. When he was doing this, he didn't know it was angel or that they were angels. He thought they were human beings. It was in the morning that the truth was revealed.
And they told him, by this time next year, that your wife will bear a son.
Sarah laughed. You know, these people don't know that I'm already 90 years. Oh, yeah. Jesus. Genesis chapter 18, verse 14, the angel says, is there anything impossible for God? I will know how the story ended.
But the good thing that Abraham did that day was not the first day he was doing good things. He had already formed the habit of doing good.
And then he did it that day to the angels. And the good thing he did brought Isaac into his life.
I am here to tell you to keep doing that good thing. Never give up. Remain faithful. Continue to look unto God. He is the rewarder of the people.
He will surely remember you. He will surely bless you. He will surely give you a recompense. Jesus, my dear people of God, you may have heard in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6, the Bible says, and without faith, it is impossible to please God.
Because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he is the rewarder of all who earnestly serve him.
I want you to take note of that. The rewarder of all who earnestly, who diligently serve him. If you continue to serve him, you will receive your promotion. You will receive a recompense from God. Oh, Jesus.
There may be obstacles,
but God will set you up. God will move you up. And let me tell you, a time came when the people, the brothers of Joseph, when they came to him, and they were wondering, maybe our brother will deal with us. He will kill us. Now that our father, Jacob, had died. But you know what? Joseph told them something very remarkable. Genesis chapter 50, verse 20.
He said, you intended to harm me. You intended to harm me. But God intended it for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives.
Oh, Jesus.
This bad thing I done against you, may be crying now. But if God allowed it and you manifest for, you will surely see that it will turn for good. That wrong thing, that bad thing, that plot to harm you will turn to good. That obstacle, that very obstacle will turn to stepping stones for you.
Jesus. My brothers and sisters, God is talking to us this night. Yes, Lord. Jesus.
We're asking him to be with us. God raised Joseph to the world stage.
And I tell you, in Genesis chapter 41, verse 57, the Bible says, all the world came to Joseph. I mean, I wasn't the one that said it. That was what the Bible put it.
All the world. People came from every part of the world to come and do what? To come and see Joseph, a foreigner in Egypt.
Promotion.
When you remain faithful to God, surely God will do something that will make you to be celebrated.
Jesus.
He did not punish his brothers and sisters who sold him into slavery. He still showed that faithfulness to them.
And that's how God treats us anyway. That no matter what we do, God remains faithful because it is in the nature of God to be faithful.
2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 13 says that even when we're not faithful, God remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself.
You see that? It is the nature of our God to be faithful. Jesus.
So, Joseph remained faithful to God, showed love to his brothers and sisters, and they saved them from famine. The famine that would have killed the family, that would have brought an end to his 11 brothers.
God used Joseph to save the life of his brothers from famine. Yes, Lord. So what does this mean to you today? What does it mean for you? It's us. Oh, my people of God. It means to me that God sees our situations. It means to me that when, though I may be in a prison-like situation, that God is preparing a glorious position for me. That's what it means. It means that God hears the prayers of my heart. It means that God is watching over me. Psalm 17, verse 8 says that I am the apple of his eyes. He watches over me. He keeps his eyes on me like a satellite. Jesus. It means to me that a day is coming when God will settle me. Yes, Lord. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 10 says, after you may have suffered a while, I will settle you. God said, I will settle you. He will settle you. He will remember you. You see that thing you are passing through today? You see that thing that Joseph passed through in the prison? He as a slave. He passed through all those things. God was watching. And God is watching you. God is watching. Don't give up. After you have passed through that season, God is coming with a reward. The Bible says that God is a rewarder of those who diligently serve him. Brothers and sisters, we are here this night to encourage ourselves in the Lord. Even David encouraged himself in the Lord. Jesus. When David's son, Absalom, chased him out of his palace, and David ran out of the palace without even slippers. I mean, that's how the Bible put it. He ran out of his palace without sandals. A whole king ran for his life. His own son chased him out of his house. Can you see what I'm talking about? The inner war, the war in the house. That is the worst war you can ever fight. The inner war, the war in the house. The terrible war. Jesus. But the Bible says that even in this situation, David encouraged himself in the Lord. We have to learn how to encourage ourselves in the Lord. Joseph encouraged himself in the Lord. Even Job encouraged himself in the Lord. When Job lost everything, when it was as if life was coming to an end, when he had nothing to hope on again, he looked up, he looked down, he shook his head and said, well, Job chapter 19, verse 25, I know that my Redeemer liveth. I know that my Redeemer liveth. That's the only thing I know. Jesus. God considers your sacrifices. Even the small ones that you think go unnoticed, God notices them. These are the lessons from the life of Joseph. Jesus. Oh, so even when you are not faithful to God, because, you know, we make a lot of mistakes, God will remain true to himself and to you. Jesus. Oh, Makuruba Sharaba. Jesus. It also means to me and to you that God is walking behind the scene of my life. Whatever you are passing through, no matter the ugliness of the situation, no matter the storm, no matter how things were going and the sky is becoming cloudy and it appears there is no hope again, God is saying, I am watching. I remember Jeremiah chapter 1 verse 12. I am watching to see that my word is fulfilled. God is telling you who is passing through turmoil, who is spending nights in tears, who have been drinking the cup of sorrow, or like David in Psalm 42, verse 3, the Bible says that, my tears have become my bread by night and day.
as I hear it said all the day long, where is your God? Maybe people are asking you that question, where is your God? Others are married, not married at your age. Where is your God? Every time you cover your hair like a saint, doing holy, holy, holy. Where are you? I was touched some time ago. A sister called me and was telling me what happened to her that day. He said, brother, when I was in college, you know, everybody knew me as a born again. I was always dressing in a born again form, always in fellowship, but I had roommates that were very worldly, and I was always preaching to them. They never listened to me. Now, many years later, probably about 20 years later, now that happened to be the day we were now talking, and she told me, "Brother, I do know I came to a gathering, and somebody walked to me and said, and called my name and said, 'Are you this person?'" He said, "Yes." I said, "How do you know me?" He said, "I was your roommate when we were years ago when we were in the same college." He said, "Wow." And then she now asked that sister talking to me. He said, "Why do you look like this? You look like somebody that things are very difficult for the person." I said, "Well, sister, I'm just passing through a lot of problems, no marriage, no job, you know, I'm suffering." He said, "Wow, with all this your prayers, with all this, your holiness, you know, mocking our sister." But I know that God is watching. I know that God is watching. In the time of Job, people thought it was over. People thought that Job was gone. But God showed up. God showed up and blessed Job mightily. God blessed Job in a way that the whole world was coming to look at Job, Job's children, to see Job's, you know, blessings. Jesus. That's the message for you. That when God finishes what he's doing in life, when you pass through that fire and you come out, God will settle you. God will settle us. Jesus. The Bible says in the book of Job, chapter 42, verse 10, and the Bible says, "And the Lord turned the captivity of Job when he prayed for his friends. Also, the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before." In other words, God gave Job double for his trouble. God blessed Job so much that even the children that he had after that, those troubles, the Bible records that people were coming from different parts of the world to come and see the children of Job because they were extremely beautiful. Job had more than what he lost. The Bible is talking to us today. Bible is telling us that the hand of God is behind the scene. You're not seeing the hand, but the hand is there, brother. Don't give up. Don't give up. You hear what I'm telling you? Wipe your tears. Don't cry again. The hand of God is behind the scene. The scene may be prison-like. The scene may be valley-like. It may be death-like. It may be full of darkness. You may not be seeing light now, but there's light coming at the end of the tunnel. Jesus. The hand of God is behind the scene. Watch out. Don't give up. The devil wants us to give up, but we shall not give up. Jesus. God is using your faithfulness to do more things, to do more than you probably can ever imagine. Continue to do that thing you're doing, the good things you're doing. When you feel imprisoned by guilt or imprisoned by fear or in resentment, God is still at work. Just tell yourself, "I know that God is at work. I don't want to take account of the things happening around me. I don't want to mind all the numerous failures I've had in this exam, in this board exam, in this promotion exam, in this promotion exam. I've been passing through, failing from year to year, but I know that the hand of God is at work.
Jesus.
I remember that sister. Every time she will anoint her womb, her stomach, and say, I know that I'm not barren. I know that God will give me my own children. She kept saying this until when the hand of God set to form the babies. Not one. She had children. That is twins.
Jesus.
As we continue to persevere, as we continue to pray and look unto the Lord, one day, the hand of God will form the cloud of blessings for you.
Jesus.
So don't give up. We have to remain faithful and committed like Joseph.
Jesus.
Let the hand of God bless us. When you feel unable to forgive someone who has wronged you, just know that God will help us, that God is at work, that God will help us to find ways to help us to soften our hearts, just as Joseph did. God will also help us in the name of Jesus. When things seemed harmless, God will see us through. Jesus. The Father is working in us. Yes, my Lord. The Lord is there, seeing us through. He's going to bring us that lamplight in the name of Jesus. Holy Father, I have delivered the message that you have permitted me to deliver to your people. And I'm praying over them, Lord, that this message bring light and grace upon your people. And also bring glory to your name in the name of Jesus. Father, as many that are struggling with unforgiveness, Father, we are praying that you remove every spirit of unforgiveness so that we shall be forgiven like you. Father, people that are struggling with faithfulness, Father, we are praying that you release the wave, the power, the anointing for faithfulness. The Father, who would touch your people in the name of Jesus. Father, people that are struggling with, that are hopeless because of what's happening around them. People that have been imprisoned like Joseph, Father, set them free to the glory of your name. Oh, Jesus. Father, who can do this if not you? You are our God. You are our Lord. You are our Redeemer. Come and touch your people. Jesus, as we gaze unto you, Father, may you return your gaze of love upon your people. Stretch your faithfulness to us, Lord. Touch us in a special way. Father, Lord, we are thanking you because we know you have taken control. Blessed be your name. Yes, my Lord. Jesus, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, El Shaddai. Thank you, Lord. Blessed be your name, Papa. Yes, Lord. Jesus. Jesus, we glorify you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen and amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We begin to cover the ministration of this night with the blood of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Jesus, we cover every word we have heard this night with the blood of Jesus. Let the power that is in the name of Jesus take absolute control in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, mighty man in battle. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Amen and amen. Amen.